Hey guys, Dagan here from PMTV UK, and welcome to another little tips and tricks video by PMT, where today I'm going to tell you guys 8 ways to make your amp and pedal tone not suck. Now you guys seem to enjoy the last video I did about sounds not sucking. It was how to make your electric guitar not suck, but that was physically just the guitar itself, the wood, the strings, all the bits of metal and the controls. Totally ignoring intentionally the amp, pedals, cables, everything that happens from when you touch your lovely guitar till it blows the crowd's heads off. Now obviously these tips are subjective, but I hold them to be true. If you have any extra tips, please comment them down below so people can see, and people that are seeing, look down below in the comments for extra tips. So without further ado, here's 8 ways to get your amp and pedal tone not to suck. Number 1, don't use too much gain. Now this is more for the beginners out there, and you could be thinking, if I want to play Meshuggah, I've got to use gain, right? I guarantee a lot of your favourite guitar players out there won't use a lot of gain. If you're starting out, you probably listen to things like AC/DC, Led Zeppelin, Van Halen. Those guys don't use all the gain. It's a lot of fun playing with the gain control though. Getting it nice and saturated so you can feed back and annoy your parents. It's a lot of fun, but keep the gain turned down. This is solely to get more clarity in your tone as well. You can use the volume control on your guitar if you think your guitar sound might be a bit too saturated. See what it sounds like with the volume turned back to about 8. I guarantee it'll tighten your tone right up and make it a bit more punchy. Obviously, if you are playing songs covered in saturation, I mentioned Meshuggah before, really heavy music, that does take a bit more EQ control to get it to be nice and punchy and clear. That's where using something like an overdrive is quite cool. If you have a nice, mildly distorted sound on your amplifier, throw in a Tube Screamer or a Boss SD1 to bring it to the next level of saturation, the next tonal plateau, as it were. But yeah, don't use too much gain, it'll make it less fizzy. Number 2, use the favored method of pedal setup. Now, as I mentioned earlier, these tips are subjective, and some of you guys might not agree with this tip, but this is the most common way that people set out pedals, okay? The pedals at the start of your chain will have the cleanest signal hitting it. If you think about it, your guitar goes through a cable, hits that first pedal. So the first pedals have to be ones that alter the signal itself as opposed to affect it. So think of it like affecting the signal is putting chorus or overdrive or delay on it. You're actually affecting it with an effect. Altering it, think of it as like a compressor. You're compressing a signal, or like an octaver. You're manipulating that initial signal line. So you often see tuners being the first thing you hit in a pedal board, also because most of them are buffered, but we'll get to that later. And then pedals that manipulate the sound itself, like a compressor or an octaver, sometimes a wah as well, because wahs sound great at the front of a chain. And then from there, you usually find overdrives into distortions. The reason there's overdrives before distortions, because you want to overdrive a signal going into a distortion. You don't want to distort a signal and then boosting it with an overdrive after. It works better the other way around. Again, totally subjective. If you don't agree with that, it's fine. After your overdrives and distortions, you normally find some modulation pedals, choruses, flanges, uni vibes, phasers, all that fun, and finally ending on delays and reverbs. If your amp has an effects loop as well, always experiment with putting choruses and delays and reverbs in the effects loop of an amp, especially if you're rocking an overdrive sound with your amp. The delays, reverbs, and some modulation pedals will sound better in the effects loop of an overdriven amp than in front of it. So that is the general consensus for setting up a pedal board. Signal manipulators into overdrives, distortions, fuzzes, then into phasers, choruses, flanges, then into your time-based effects, delays, and reverbs. This isn't set in stone, of course. Part of the fun of playing guitar is experimenting with pedals like this, because you can't break anything. It's all this kind of tonal manipulation, isn't it? Take Eric Johnson, for example, an amazing guitar player. Everyone knows Cliffs of Dover, right? And he rocks a delay pedal in the front of an overdriven amp. I said before, that's not the best way to do it, and it does sound a bit all over the shop, and it works for him, and it sounds phenomenal when he does it. So experiment yourself. It's a lot of fun to play with pedals. Some people prefer wahs at the front of the chain or at the end of the chain. It's pretty cool. Like I say, you can't break anything, so have some fun playing with it all. Don't know what that was. Number 3, have a tone for the situation that you're in. Now this one's pretty interesting, and I've had to take this tip on board myself on a number of occasions. And what I mean by having tone for your own situation is, if you're the only guitar player in a band, you can have your sound. If there's 2 guitar players in your band, your favourite sound in the world might not work with that other player. Now it's common knowledge, especially by looking at me in these black nails, that I'm a big 80s rock guy. I love a bit of glam rock, a bit of all that Van Halen, Motley Crue and all that malarkey. So my guitar tone, I have in the house and in some bands is very 80s. JSM 800 kind of vibe with a tube screamer, nice and rocky. In a band situation with another guitar player, they don't really mix. You've got to work together as musicians, both of you guys together, to find tones that complement each other. And obviously if you want to rock a solo, you can get your own sound and make a cut through the mix. But when playing together with other musicians, you've got to have enough character in you, and I know it's hard as a guitar player, to get your tones to marry each other so it sounds great for the crowd. Number four, try not to buy cheap pedal power supplies. And I know if musicians can save money, we totally will, but there's so many cheap power supplies out there that people buy and then come into a PMT store and say, my pedal's broken, it's making a crazy noise, there's a lot of hum when I'm playing guitar, and it's because it's a cheap power cable. We all know the sound of a buzzing power supply, don't we? It's awful. So spend that little bit more, get yourself a slightly better quality isolated power supply, whether it be for a daisy chain or a proper DC brick or a Voodoo Labs pedal power. You will thank me later and your sound will be crystal clear. Plus, they do last a bit longer as well. Buying cheap power supplies not only sound crap, but they're kind of like disposable. You buy one for a couple of weeks, chuck it out because it's broken, etc, etc. Spend a bit more, get the next level up, or whatever level you can afford. It'll be so much better for you, I promise. Number five, most amps sound different when they're loud rather than when they're played quiet. Now these days, a lot of amps come with attenuators built in so you can get that kind of crank sound in the house, and that certainly does help. But it's kind of physics the way amps sound different loud than quiet. When they're louder, the little speaker cone is moving more and pushing more air, therefore generating more movement in the room you're in or the stadium you're in, so therefore it will sound different. This is knowing that you guys watching this will one day become super famous and therefore play stadiums. Save me a VIP ticket, okay? So if you're a gigging musician, try and find a space where you can crank your amp up and sculpt your live sound. Obviously, amps these days sound great when they're quiet compared to even 10, 20 years ago. They sounded crap quiet, but now amps with the attenuators and like I mentioned before, do sound great at low volumes, but you've got to get that good live sound going with some air moving. There's no shame in just you rocking up to your local rehearsal room, amp in hand, guitar on your back, and just jamming by yourself with a loud amp for an hour. It'll really help you shape your tone. And like I mentioned before, especially if you're playing with other musicians, both you guys play loud together to get your tones to match nicely. Speaking of rehearsal spaces, most places these days have their own amps in-house, which is amazing. It saves you having to carry your amp on the bus, on the tube, or in the back of your mum's car. But if you can, always try and rehearse with your own amp, so when you get on stage, you're comfortable with the sound and with the band. Number six, a fun little tone tip, which was told to me by the techs at Marshall Amplification. Start with your amp at everything at 12 and then manipulate it from there. Now I'm talking about EQ here, don't go starting at your volume on a 200 watt Blackstar head halfway up, just the EQ. 99% of most amps, the EQ on the front of them will start at zero and work their way up to 10 or 11 if you're Nigel Tufnell. So starting with the EQ halfway up is great because you can add more and take some away if you want. I see a lot of guys with their first amp or just starting out, start at zero and work the way up from there. And you kind of don't get the full idea of what the amp can do. You're kind of scared almost to really crank it. But you can do an Yngwie Malmsteen if you want and turn everything up to 10. It'll sound cool, but it might not be the most versatile tone in the world. So start with everything at noon, at five almost. Take things away or add things in as your ears deem necessary. Each amp has its own sweet spot as well. I was told by the techs at Marshall that told me this little fact that 1 o'clock on all the EQ controls is the sweet spot for Marshalls. That's where I run mine and I think it sounds awesome. Check out the video that went live on the PMTV UK YouTube channel too, where we gave Aid Emsley from Orange Amps some questions, the chief designer engineer from Orange Amps. He's been there for years and he talks about where the sweet spots are on Orange Amps. Number seven, use a mixture of buffered and true bypass pedals. Now, I'm not going to get into the massive debate, which you will find online, between true bypass and buffered pedals. I'll give you a little diluted version right now. Now, a buffered pedal, the best way to describe a buffer is when your guitar sound leaves the pedal, it's been slightly affected by the circuit within said pedal. It usually colours it ever so slightly and keeps it at that level. Now, that's like pouring soil into a guitar purist's ear hearing that. It colours the sound. How dare this tiny boss pedal color my sound? I need true bypass everything. And what true bypass is that when your guitar sound enters a pedal and leaves, it's exactly the same whether the pedal's on or off. Buffered, when the pedal's off, like I said, it affects it. True bypass pedals, when the pedal is off, It's totally unaffected, like it's an extra bit of cable. But cable is the reason you should have true bypass and buffered pedals. Say you've got a few pedals on your pedal board and some pedals in the effects loop of your amplifier. All of them are true bypass, every last one of them. And you're using 20-foot guitar cables. 20-foot from your guitar to the start of the pedals. All the little patch cables, all true bypass. Then 20-foot to the front of your amplifier. Excellent. That's 45-foot with the patch cables in. 20-foot to the effects pedals in the effects loop. More patch cables and 20-foot back again. That's like 85, 90-foot of cable. The longer the cable, the more tone you lose in the cable. It knocks the high end off. So if you had true bypass cables and true bypass pedals and all of those cables, your guitar sound would be like this at the end of it. So you need these buffers in your pedals to boost the sound up. A lot of pedals you can switch between true bypass and buffered, because buffered isn't a dirty word, even though online on forums you'll see proper old guitar farts being like, everything needs to be true bypass, buffered colours your sound so much. Maybe the buffered pedals of the past coloured it in an awful way. But I've got some old Boss pedals that sound absolutely amazing, whether they're turned on or off, so you be the judge. You need buffered pedals to stop your guitar tone diminishing through all that cable. And they're not hard to find at all. Maybe a nice Boss tuner at the start, that's a nice buffer, a Boss delay or reverb at the end, great buffers, most wahs are buffers as well. It's not hard to find a good buffered pedal or a good true bypass pedal. They both sound great, not necessarily better or worse than the other, you just need a good mixture of the two to keep your guitar signal sounding good. And finally, number 8, mid-range is important, even if you play metal. Now, I know not all metal has a crazy scooped mid-range, okay? But I remember reading magazines back in the day saying, to get a good metal sound, you need to boost the bass, boost the treble, and take all the mids out to get that scooped sound. That scooped sound, the word scoop, is going to be used a lot in this little section. Scooped sound is the quintessential metal sound. Kind of tonally, yes, if you're playing by yourself in your bedroom and you want that kind of scooped sound. But the guitar itself is a mid-range instrument. You need those mids, guys, if you're playing with your band or even playing along with a record on the radio. Record on the radio? How about Spotify or YouTube to bring it to the 21st century? You need those mids in so you can cut through and hear yourself. It'll just get lost in the mix otherwise. You can still have a scooped sound with mids to slightly bump up the bass and the treble, but don't take out all the mids. You need it to cut through the mix. You could do something cool, which is what Dimebag Darrell from Pantera used to do back in the day, and Eddie Van Halen, and that is to add, it's quite cool, it's a nice little tip for the end of this little video. What they used to do is scoop the mids out on the amp and get a EQ pedal and boost the mids, so they're having contrasting scooped mids on the amplifier with an EQ pedal with some boosted mids. Have them together to make some tonal craziness happen, and you get that scooped sound, as well as having some mid poke so you can cut through the mix. That's a fun little fact for you for free. But yes, can't stress enough, mid-range is important. You can still get a scooped sound, just keep the mid-range not at zero, okay? So that's it, guys, 8 ways to make your amp and pedal sound not suck. Let me know what you think of them down below in the comments, and if you have any extra tips for people, let them know as well. People watching this, check out the comments for probably lots of Russell Brand comments, but also tips and tricks to make your pedal and amp sound better. Even if you want to alter or change any of my tips, feel free to. Guitar is all about having fun and learning, whether you're a beginner or a pro. And if you enjoy that, ladies and gents, hit the like button down below and subscribe to PMTV UK on YouTube for lots more cool guitar and music related content. If you want any more information on any amps, pedals, effects or anything, get yourself over to pmtonline.co.uk or call into one of our forever expanding, beautiful PMT stores and have a chat with one of the Maras in there. We are PMT House of Rock on Twitter, Instagram and Facebook. Give us a like and a follow to see pictures of cool musical stuff with filters on them. I've been Dagan. Hope you enjoyed that and it's helped. I'll see you next time. Cheers.